Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Claude Carboneau, and I'm a parishioner here at St. Brendan. Thank you for allowing me just a few moments to speak about the 2020 Catholic Appeal. First, I wish to offer you the thanks and gratitude of the thousands of men, women, and children in our diocese who have been profoundly impacted by your generosity in the past. I ask that you once again provide critical support to the many programs and ministries supported by the appeal. Through your generosity, you have shared God's love with so many in Maine. Each year, your support directly serves the spiritual and material needs of so many at the moments when they are most in need, provides care and companionship to seniors in their own homes, allows children and young adults to find joy in knowing Christ, and funds programs which allow our church to shine as a symbol of hope, strength, and resilience. Personally, I have witnessed the impacts of your generosity on the spiritual lives of three men within our parish. Deacon Bob Curtis has, until COVID-19, been able to spend 4 days per week at the Maine State Prison. Your contributions have made available the materials he has needed to hold RCIA sessions at the prison. His work and that of Father Bob's led directly to the conversion of three inmates at the prison who joined our Catholic Church a little over a year ago. Henry, Wayne, and Bob are now full members of our parish community thanks to your contributions to the appeal. All of these good works have been made possible because of your commitment to the Catholic Church in Maine and your generous gifts to the annual appeal. I hope you're moved by what your donations have accomplished and are inspired to do so again as we continue to answer God's call to serve. If you have not already done so, I ask you now, please support the 2020 Catholic Appeal. All the good that we accomplish is because of your generosity. I would like to remind you that your donations and every dollar remain here in Maine. Also, thank you to all those who have already committed to this year's 2020 Catholic Appeal. Contributions can be made through the materials available at the table at the entrance to the hall or online at www.portlanddiocese.org/give. You'll also find a letter from our bishop on the appeal in your bulletin. Thank you for your time. And please continue to pray for the success of the 2020 Catholic Appeal. Walk daily with Jesus.
Good morning again, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Brendan, the Navigator Parish and Our Lady of Good Hope Church. Today's the 21st Sunday in ordinary time. Please take a moment to silence or turn. turn off your cell phones. A reminder that face masks must be worn during Mass and must cover the entire nose and mouth. If you are receiving communion on the tongue, please receive at the end of the communion line. We are the Church, the universal assembly of believers, the body of Christ, called to build the kingdom of God. Each of us is part of this institution that can be traced back nearly 2,000 years to St. Peter, the rock on whom we are built. As we celebrate the Eucharist here today, let us reflect on this awesome privilege of being a part of this 2,000-year-old mission and contemplate what we are called to do to bring it closer to perfection. Mass today will be offered by Carolyn Kelly. Now let's have a moment of silence as we prepare for the celebration of Mass.
Our gathering song for this afternoon is number 385, City of God, number 385.
Oh, who calls the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose. Grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to Shebna, master of the palace, I will thrust you from your office and pull you down from your station. On that day I will summon my servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe and gird him with your sash, and give over to him your authority. He shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. I will place the key of the house of David on Eliakim's shoulder. When he opens, no one shall shut. When he shuts, no one shall open. I will fix him like a peg in a sure spot to be a place of honor for his family. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given the Lord anything, that he may be repaid. For from him, and through him, and for him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, in the conversation that takes place between Jesus and his disciples in the gospel text we have followed, we get the narrative of Matthew about how Jesus makes his disciples to begin to understand him in a new way. Now they will begin to know even more and more that their master, Jesus Christ, is the Son of God, the Messiah. This conversation also marks a turning point in the mission of Peter, who is one of the disciples. And we know in the tradition of the Bible how when God calls people and changes their name, it signifies the change of their mission. So the mission of Simon is no longer going to be simply follower of Christ, but leader as the followers of Christ. After his confession of Jesus Christ as the Son of the living God, Jesus tells him, "You are Peter, you are Simon. Oh, Simon, blessed are you. I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you bound, you lose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." These words from Jesus confer on Peter, Simon, a new name, a name which means rock, Peter. He is the rock because of his faith. Actually, the rock is his faith. And it is upon this faith that Jesus, who is the Messiah, is going to give Peter to be the leader of the disciples. He is going to form around himself a group, a company of his followers, headed by Peter. Peter is going to be the speaker and the example of the faith of that company of apostles or disciples. And as long as that faith that belongs to Peter and the community endures, then the gates of the netherworld will not have the power to overcome the group of disciples. And the good news is that group actually now is the church. So as long as our faith endures, no power from the netherworld can overcome us, no evil power. By conferring the keys of the kingdom to Peter, Jesus indicates that the position of leadership and authority will belong to him, to Peter. And that reminds us of the first reading for today, in which we hear God say that he will place the key of the house of David on Eliakim's shoulder. When he opens, no one shall shut, and when he shuts, no one shall open. That makes us to stop a bit and ask the meaning of the key, the symbol of the key, even in the tradition of the people of Israel. The key was a symbol of the office of the master of the palace, the highest officer of the court of Israel. And so if Peter is given the key to the kingdom, he is made to be the master of the palace that is a community of believers, and that is the church. The meaning of the office that is conferred on Peter is also specified by conferring on him the power to loose and to bind and to loose. In that power of binding and loosing, the church, when she formulated her doctrine, would see the power to bind and to loose as the origin of the authority in the church to absolve the sins of its members. That power would be the origin of the power in the church to teach the doctrine of the faith in ways that are binding, leading its members to the kingdom. The authority to bind and to loose will also be the origin of the church, the power of the church, to make decisions that lead its members in the way of faith. So the authority is therefore exercised in the office of the person of the Pope, who is the head of the bishops. It is in the ministry of the Pope, as we heard at the introduction to this Mass, that we see the visible sign of the authority of the Church. I would like us to meditate today in only one aspect, and we could call it the outcome of the authoritative office of Peter, the office of the Pope. And it is explained to us in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. I would like to use the word. The Catechism says, the Pope is the perpetual and the visible source and the foundation of the unity, both of the bishops as successors of the apostles and of the whole community of the faithful. And I would like that aspect to come out, especially in our meditation. The fact that the Pope is the visible sign, source of our unity. But the unity also dwells in the bishops and in the whole company of the faithful. So the unity dwells also in us. And the Pope is the source of it. The person, when we see the visible sign, then we see how the church is united. In a very special way, St. Paul explains how the essence of our unity exists, the oneness of our church. I would like to use the words of St. Paul, taken from the letter to the Ephesians. He says, there is one body and one spirit, just as there is one hope to which God calls all of you. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There is one God and Father of all people, who is Lord of all. He works through all and is in all. In those words, we can understand the essence of the oneness, the unity of the church. And so the office or the person of the Pope is therefore the visible sign of that oneness that dwells actually in the whole body, the church. And from that oneness, from that unity, the church, and especially we as members of that community, we can have the courage, and we have the authority also, to address the wounds and the hatred and the division that sometimes characterize our societies and our families. If we truly belong to one body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, then anything that divides has to disturb us. We must question how the people who belong to that oneness can have the wounds of hatred and division at the same time. This same month of August, 3 years ago, the Conference of Bishops of the United States of America, they addressed a letter, an apostolic letter, to the whole community of the faithful and people of goodwill in this country. And they called the name of that wound, or those wounds, of hatred and division. And I would like to quote to you how they termed those wounds. They are white supremacy, anti-Semitism, neo-Nazism, fascism, racism. Those are wounds to the oneness of the church, the unity of Christian faithful. The bishops of America told us that these are evil and have no place in our nation. When I mentioned our nation in the morning at Belfast, you don't talk to me that I am really a Cameroonian. So I said, your nation. But I also said, no way. Cameroon also has so many tribes. In fact, 220 and 50 above. And especially in our times, our days, when all kinds of divisions are coming up in various ways in America, it's also happening in Cameroon. It's a lot of racism, a lot of tribalism. just like here it is racism and the rest. So these words, therefore, they address all of us. Evil has no place in our nations, in our neighborhoods, in our hearts, because we are Christians and we belong to that oneness that we have described above. The manifestation of these evils and their effects on our humanity are so real, and they are poisonous, actually. And we can call it almost that it is the gates of the netherworld that are opening up in our own time. So we have to rely on our faith, go back to our faith and to the origin of our oneness, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, who is Father of us all. We have to go back to that, to face squarely these gates of the netherworld that are opening up in our time. We proclaim that we are one as humanity, even before we are one in Christ. We have the courage to deny what brings hatred, what brings division. So we pray, brothers and sisters, for the courage to bring healing to our families and to our society. When we look at the office of Peter and see the oneness of the church, let us all as Christians stand against those who bring division. Let us pray that we can be part of healing, not part of wounding.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for us salvation, he came down from him. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified with Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one, the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, as we now make a prayer for our community and for the world, let us pray to Christ the Lord, not only for ourselves, but because we are united, let us pray for all who belong to the church.
For our current successor, to St. Peter, Pope Francis, that God may continue to guide him in wisdom and knowledge to build up Christ's church here on earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For wise leaders, public servants who work patiently and diligently for peace in a violent world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the lives and property lost from wildfires in California, that the deceased may find rest in the Lord, their families, consolation, and those left without homes may be able to rebuild their lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who fear the sacrament of reconciliation, that they may recognize the graces of true healing and freedom that come from God's forgiveness and mercy in this holy sacrament, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are troubled in spirit, especially parents of children who have turned away from the faith, that through the intercession of Saint Monica and her son, Saint Augustine, whose feast days we celebrate this week, parents may trust in the love and mercy of the Good Shepherd. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish, that it will grow in faith and respect for all believers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace this week to trust in God's inscrutable judgments and unsearchable ways, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
This Mass is being offered for Caroline Kelly. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Turn your merciful ear to our prayers, we ask, O Lord, and listen in kindness to the supplications of those who call on you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
The Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his eternal church.
O Lord, who gains for yourself a people by adoption, through the one sacrifice offered once and for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, and made the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit, might to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as a church. And so in company with choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Taking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, and Robert our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. in our life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God and Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. We invite our brothers and sisters who are following the Mass on Facebook to make a prayer of spiritual communion in this prayer as we say, My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
We invite those on the left-hand side of the church to come to the portion. Thank you.
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please bring your used missals with you when you leave your pew and deposit them in the box near the exit in the hall. Leave the kneeler down in your pew so our helpers will know which pews have been occupied so that they can disinfect them after Mass. We invite you to kneel for a few moments after the final hymn to pray silently for vocations and peace in the world for all people.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Have a good week.
Our final song of praise is number 498.